Hello and welcome back to the Not the Old Firm YouTube channel. My name is Ben Banks. Wasn't expecting to record this, whilst perhaps some might say it was on the horizon. There was still, at least for me, a wee bit of a shock factor to read on Monday night that Derek McInnes was no longer Aberdeen manager. He'd been there for 8 years. He's taken them to multiple cup finals, semi-finals, European runs, second place finishes, and of course the League Cup victory in 2014. But results as of late haven't been good enough. They are fourth still in the Scottish Premiership, but they have only scored one goal in their last 9 matches. A poor run of form which has culminated in McInnes leaving the club by mutual consent. He was the longest serving manager, at least in the Scottish Premiership, 8 years and one manager job is fairly lengthy in the modern game. Overall, I think he'll be looked at in a positive light by Aberdeen fans. To look back on his tenure and a bit about his own coaching aspirations, well, we were joined by former Aberdeen defender Zander Diamond to look back on Derek McInnes' reign, what went right, what went wrong, who potentially could take over at Pittodrie, as well as his own coaching ambitions. He's going his own personal training with young aspiring footballers as Zander Diamond. So all of that and more in the video you are about to watch. Do remember to like this video, subscribe to the channel. We'll have a written piece with Zander as well on our website. All the links to that in the description below, where you can also find out a wee bit more about Zander's coaching. Anyway, enough of my rambling. Here's my video with Zander Diamond. Do remember to like this video, subscribe to the channel, and until next time, take it easy. So before getting into the Derek McInnes chat, you're obviously busy time for you with coaching, family life and things like that. So you've sat on top of your Queen's Park coaching, set up your own wee business of coaching as well.
Yeah, Ben, I just decided at the turn of the year, and it was actually listening to the Michelle Moan podcast that it got me thinking. She said, if you've got an idea, go with it. So I had all the equipment. It's getting the clients and obviously obeying the rules. So I spoke to the local MP and she said, like, you know, as long as rules are adhered to. So yeah, so managed to get a few players in, and I said the angle that I'm coming at is bespoke. So if it's a centre back, it's all centre back drills and tailored running towards them. If it's centre mid, totally different from that. Strikers again, totally different. So the way I seen it was when you know, it's a range of ages I've got, but there's boys that are older now who are looking to kick on into under-18s football at professional level. So they've got to have a kind of pre-season know-how or running in their legs. They kind of go up to the 18s or the 21s and suddenly there's a shock to the system. So my running's tailored to that, and so there's no any surprises for them. And it's been good. You know, there's been a lot of the clients keep coming back, which is good, which is the main thing. So it seems to be working, but it's great working with them. Obviously, you can't go in team environment. So to see them one-to-one and, you know, and designing, you know, every day you're designing a different session, and, you know, not one session is the same. So that's a great thing. There's a freshness and a variety about it. And like you say, family life, my wife's expecting her second child on May. So yeah, so busy, and, you know, hopefully with the vaccine getting rolled out, the restrictions are left, and we'll be back at Queen's Park. So it's all hands to the pump, and, you know, I'd rather be kind of busy and active rather than sitting about, you know. So, and also on the top of that, looking to get into the game in some possible way, and that's like designing pre-seasons, designing what I would look for, you know, just a lot of homework to be done if I was to go to a board member or a chief executive to say, listen, I'm interested in a job. So just keeping a finger on the pulse and looking at what sometimes you write in the media. So it's all good.
Yeah, us big bad media, we're getting an absolute bashing off of everybody in the last 24 hours. I wonder why. But very, very different circumstances, it must be said. But you'll not be doing many centre mids and strikers, surely, no?
No, I'd be surprised. I've got a few, you know, probably, yeah, centre-back you want to tailor, but I think I've got one that everybody wants to be a striker. You know, I wanted to be a striker and midfielder, so you're putting your expertise, but it's great because they ask you questions all the time, you know, and that's the beauty of it. Kids will surprise you, and, you know, a different range, you know, different players at different levels, and it's much different from the team environment where, you know, I was working with a player that he was within a team, but you take him out of that and you study him one-to-one, and there's wee things you can help him with and wee percentages, you know, where that's stronger on one side to try and get that strong on the other side. And it's just wee things like that, and to the eye, you know, where they can really, really hone in on them and give feedback, and then within about, you know, a few weeks later, they're sort of doing it, and it's helping them. It's getting that, you know, if it's a striker, it's getting that extra half yard. And, you know, it's quite intense to begin with, because you've got to give a feeler sessions to a few of them and see. There's no point in giving like short, sharp sessions if they've not got the fitness, which I'm big on. I like the fitness aspect. So they'll get a lot of hard running, a lot of running that I've done, and a lot of running that I've seen throughout careers. It does work to sort of get you to the next level or prepare you to go to the next level. So as I said, that's my sort of angle to come in. And then you'll get your short and sharp stuff that which comes, and the sharpen them up and all that. But no, it's great. As I said, you know, if you can pass on half of what you learned and they take it on board, then hopefully they go on and fulfill what potentially they want to do. And, you know, my motto is attitude, appetite and ambition. Everybody's ambitious to be a footballer, but you've got to have the right ingredients, i.e. the attitude and appetite. You know, if you've got the wrong attitude, then it all falls by the wayside. If you've got the attitude to turn up, but you've not got the appetite, you really put it in, I demand 100%. Then that falls by the wayside. So they're all three work in tandem, and you know, I keep saying that to them, keep reminding them, but it worked for me in my career, and you know, it wasn't a too bad career that I had. So yeah, so hopefully these guys go on progress, and you've played a small part. But as I said, it's just up and running just now, and we'll hopefully see more guys coming in the future, and then girls as well. You know, it's sort of bespoke to both genders.
Yeah. So obviously you've got coaching ambitions. If you're going to be really ambitious, there's a job in the Northeast, which title of article said video that you'll be reading or watching. Obviously a club you're well associated with, Aberdeen, after 8 years. Derek McInnes has literally been Aberdeen manager throughout my entire teams. So it's going to be completely bizarre to see somebody else in the Pittodrie dugout. Obviously left the club Monday night. And while perhaps it was always going to be a day where he left, I suppose the shock factor was still there. I don't know if it was the same for you, but I was quite, even though it was perhaps coming, I was still quite shocked to see it.
Yeah, I got a few texts from friends that live in Aberdeen, and they'd say that McInnes had left, or mutual consent, or whatever way you want to call it. Surprised at the timing. And, you know, I still thought maybe to the end of the season, you know, we're in March now, still got a Scottish Cup to play, and they're still kind of all to play for the top three, basically. But shock, possibly not, because there has been sort of rumbles and throughout the years that, you know, first and foremost, I think Derek and Tony Dockett's done a remarkable job up there. I think they went in and steadied the ship, took the club back to where they wanted to be, winning silverware. You know, unfortunately, I never won silverware at the football club when I was there, and they went and won it. So, you know, that shocked, but you know, I mean, Aberdeen fans wanted change, and sometimes change isn't good enough. Doesn't work out. So, like you say, there was a shock factor, but surprise, possibly at the timing, but no really kind of towards sort of the kind of dismissal or the walk away, whatever the agreement is, because we'll never know in the media, you know, you'll never understand that. But they said it'll be interesting to see who they go and get. You know, there's been a few whispers of ex-players in the current set up there with Paul Shearer and that. But it'll be interesting to see who they go and get. You know, sometimes change brings a lot of upheaval. And I said it'll be interesting again next season to see who comes in, hits the ground running, and see where they're at.
Yeah, because it has, from what I've seen, while Aberdeen fans are perhaps not exactly best pleased with even the last sort of two or three seasons, because they have just sort of, even though they're still finishing third or fourth, a club like Aberdeen probably should be there. But obviously, looking back on your playing days, even towards the end, if you consider where they were perhaps 10 years compared to where they are now, it's night and day.
Yeah, of course it is. You know, he steadied the club. After Jimmy Calder, there was a lot of change. Now, we changed Jimmy after 5 years, and I don't think the club, you know, I know Mark came in, I know Craig came in, and I don't think there was a bit of stability. Derek certainly brought that when he came into the football club. It's one of them things. It's, you know, the fans, it seems nowadays, like when fans talk, it seems directors and board like sort of listen now, and you know, but the job can't go unnoticed what he's did. You know, what do the Aberdeen fans want? And you know, the demand's there all the time to go and challenge and go and get silverware. You know, Derek went and done that. If you're saying to try and compete to win the league championship, you know, it's, I think it's near enough over 30 years since somebody outside Old Firm won the championship. So you're up against that. But I just find that, you know, sometimes it's not, you know, what more do you want? And with that, I mean, you know, he finished second two or three times. He's always been in the top four by his first season. So what more do you want? Because everybody starts off at the beginning of the season, even the teams that had finished down the bottom, you know, the challenge is to go and get in the top six or the top four. Realistically, are Aberdeen going to be competing with Old Firm? Highly unlikely, because they've got the budgets. Now, I don't know what the wage budget is up there just now, but if you look at, in comparison, Celtic go and sign a goalkeeper for £5 million, probably Aberdeen's budget is half that, if not less, you know, for a wage budget, you know. So that's the flex that the Old Firm have got. So, you know, Derek's rebuilt the team every single year. After having good finishes, you know, it'd be great if they actually had a consistency with the players just staying at his disposal and adding to it. You know, we know they ran Celtic close that year, but ultimately failed just at the end. But that's Celtic again flexing the muscles. They know how to win championships. So again, sometimes you wish for a change, but sometimes inevitably might not be a good thing.
Yeah. I suppose the thing with Aberdeen, at least from my perspective, is there was that season, the Ronnie Dyla season, where Aberdeen were very, very close and perhaps just needed to push on a wee bit more and they would have, because Celtic were very vulnerable that season, and they never quite did it. And they've been to umpteen Scottish Cup finals and League Cup finals. I think it was 9 semi-finals in total in his reign, and they've only won a trophy. I think the thing is that they've been so close so many times, but it's only brought about the one trophy. I think that's where some of the frustration comes from.
Yeah, that's frustration as well, you know, and that was Jimmy, that was most of the fans' grievances with Jimmy. You know, we got to a few umpteen semi-finals, and even with Craig and Archie, we got to two and we didn't get there. Derek was fortunate enough to go and win a trophy. If you're saying the season at Celtic go and win the treble, you know what I mean? It's Aberdeen competed with him in that game. You know, Derek gets tactics spot on that day, and if it wasn't for a bit of magic for Rogic, then it could have been so much different. You know, so yeah, they've been there, but it was always a case of, yeah, they want the next step to go and win a trophy. But if we touch on again the season they ran Celtic close, with that, there becomes an expectation again the next season. Can we do it again? Can we do it again? You know, I don't know what the point margin was the following season for that, but Celtic probably gets spooked in a way, you know, this shouldn't be happening, because with Rangers not being there, it's like, well, you know, and out with the kind of the West Coast, it's only Celtic and Rangers that win it. So they'll be saying, well, why is a team like Aberdeen or whoever's getting close to us? We'll just need to go and spend again, and then become with the financial power again, you know, with if they find like somebody's getting too close to them, they might go and spend. So yeah, so but as I said, expectations always been there for a club Aberdeen, you know, even when I was there, and it'll still be there for the next manager and the next manager. They'll demand success. Every supporter does, every supporter wants to go and win it, and we get the frustration. As I said, change was inevitable, because I think with Derek and the run of results, that sort of ultimately kind of put pay to that. The timing again was a wee bit miffed. You know, he still had a chance to go and try and do something this year. And I think he should have had the time to do that, because his stock is quite high with the Aberdeen. But again, the frustration, the fans talking, and, you know, a wee bit of pressure goes on. You know, I know they're fourth just now with a game in hand. So sometimes directors or whatever get spooked with that as well, and we need to finish third for financial gain. You know, we've lost a lot of money due to the COVID pandemic, but every club's like that as well. So yeah, so like you say, it's there's frustration on that element, but everybody's sort of in the same boat. But again, nine semi-finals and one trophy, you know, but he's got there. He's been in finals as well, and obviously no, just been able to cap it off, but he's come up against like good Celtic sides in that, and bar at a stroke of luck, you know, they could be sitting there with more trophies in the cabinet.
Yeah, I think as well, we spoke a bit about it before we hit record, but he's been there 8 years, and I mean, you look around world football, never mind Scottish football now, and you try and pick out managers who've been at clubs for 8 years, it's not very often. Speaking to one of the people who's linked to it, Stephen Robinson, saying that perhaps you get to 4 years at a club and you and the club need a change. I'd assume that's probably quite exasperated when you get to 8 years.
Yeah, well, 8 years, you know, for my own time being there as a player, 8 years, 9 years, I was there as a young kid. So you're there a long time, then you become part of the furniture, and then you might take your eye off the ball, not saying I did or Derek did, but 8 years is a long time in football, especially in this day and age. And I think we spoke about it was the longest serving manager in the SPFL, in the SPL, sorry. So yeah, but he still rebuilt. He still had the fire to go and churn out results and get top four, top three league standings, you know, finishes. So he still had that there. It just, at the end, it might have just kind of pittered out or whatever. Or sometimes, you know, you look at the run of results and, you know, ultimately results, it's a results-driven business. And one, I think, two wins in 12, 13 games and one goal in nine, you know. So that doesn't really fit. But usually, you know, I read a great book with Carl Ancelotti and he says, like, a 3 years thing. You know, you go into a football club and the first and foremost, you need to steady the ship. And that's what he did. And then the next season he goes and wins the cup. And it's a good league finish from the previous year. And then suddenly he didn't drop that. You know, didn't get to finals or semi-finals. He was still there with the league position. So, and with a final here and there. But like you say, 3 years, 4 years is a shell. But to go eight, you know, it's a hell of a long time to be up there. But I said, like, you can't fault his dedication. He's been there that long and he's rebuilt squads. He's used the budget at hand, you know, a brand new training complex that he's overseen. And, you know, so he's actually left Aberdeen possibly in a better place than they inherited, in my opinion. So that's progress for me. Yes, you want to get a couple of trophies and along the way, but he's progressed the club and, you know, it's set up for somebody to come in and ignite it, if that's what the fans want, if that's what the team needs, and see what it takes them.
Yeah, I think you can't argue that he hasn't left it in a better place. I think even one of the smaller things is, like, I know he pushed very hard for the Cormac training facility. That's going to be for not just the next manager, but the next generation of Aberdeen players coming through and different things like that. So it's not just on the park, but he's done a lot off it as well, the player sales as well. Sam Cosgrove just in January went for $3 million. I'm not trying to say it was doing a stellar job by the end. I mean, one goal in nine games isn't exactly great, but
yeah,
it definitely did a lot of good things at that club that far outweighed the bad for me.
Of course, and you said, like, you know, he brought, was it $5 million in for McKenna, or $3-4 million in for McKenna, and like you said, touching on the training complex, all the time I was at Aberdeen, we never had a training base, so that's there for the next manager to go in to attract players, to attract, you know, to develop the next generation of Aberdeen players, to see, you know, it's a fantastic training facility. And, you know, it's there for a manager to go in and really get his hands dirty and, you know, see what he can do with the club, because it's all there. Derek went in and that wasn't there. I think he was sort of miffed with the training facilities. You know, they were getting the minibuses out, similar to what we did for years. And, you know, but now they've got this space where they can go and they can work every day away from the stadium, away from the city, and, you know, and produce the next generation or produce the next squad of players to go and challenge whatever the expectation lies at the next manager's door.
Yeah, and some of us will still get stuck in the Hamilton Palace here in the Central Belt.
That's right, aye.
But none of our complaints about that. Overall, I mean, touched on a wee bit, but how do you think he, perhaps just now it'll be a bit sore for Aberdeen fans just because of the run they've been on recently, but I think maybe in 2 or 3 months' time, when the dust settles, Derek McInnes will be looked back on fondly.
He's got to be looked back fondly. As you said, we spoke about it throughout this transmission. He's progressed the club. He's won a trophy, something the fans had been demanding since 1995 was the last time they won a trophy. So it was a long time coming. So to go and win a trophy, he got that monkey off the back, really, to say, listen, I've won a trophy. So that's great. League positions, yes, they've been up and down, but he's always remained in the top four. European football, you know, we're in this day and effort, we want to touch on more. The European football, when we played, it was a one-off game against Dnipro. That was fine. Aberdeen need to go through four qualifiers. The time they get to the fourth qualifier, it's sort of like Champions League-esque teams that they're playing against with budgets that are basically huge compared to Aberdeen. So he's had a go and he's had a go. I think that was ultimately, again, they want to recreate what we did with Jimmy and the squad of players that we had. But we only played one game. And that's what I'm saying, that one-off game. We played in Europe that year and we won one game of football but played eight games. You know, so you look at that, but Derek's tried and tried and starting pre-seasons so early, you know, and there again, the credit has to go with, you know, starting a pre-season in near enough at the end of June and finishing in May. You know, it's near enough 11 months, but still having high league positions, kind of competing in the cups, going to cup finals. So, yeah, he's, you know, I mean, I think he's been a success. He'll be hurting just now because no manager likes to sort of walk away from a job that he's done. But I tell you what, there'll be no shortage of shooters out there. If jobs come available, Derek will be high up there with his number two as well, Tony Docherty. So yeah, there's change in place, and we'll just wait and see how that goes. You know, we could go good. Hopefully it goes good, but it could go the other way as well. So they've got their way. You know, I mean, certain fans wanted Derek out. You know, not even this season, like a few years ago, and because he's seen the team sort of stumbling and all that. But listen, they've got the change, they've got their wish, and then we'll see what happens now with hopefully a manager comes in and kicks them on a wee bit.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see what Derek McInnes does, because he knocked back the Rangers job, I think it was in 2017. Like, not just that, but how different Scottish football could potentially look if he took that. But yeah, I suppose what's for you won't go by and all that.
Exactly that, you know, in the direction of what, you know, who would have, you know, I mean, if Derek takes the Rangers job, Stevie Gerrard doesn't come up, and then everything, you know, you don't know what might happen. You say it's that sliding doors effect where he shows a bit of loyalty to Aberdeen, and then Stephen comes up and obviously does a good job at Rangers. So, you know, I mean, it would be interesting to see who they go for. You see a few names getting touted about, and the one that kind of looks good is Stephen Glass on paper. I think that one looks sort of a wee bit, it looks quite tasty, that one.
Aye, it's I think that one's going to be, I don't know what the Scottish sort of social media and all of that. I mean, Aberdeen and Celtic looking for managers at the same time, going to be absolutely sick of it by the time it gets to sort of May time. But I think Stephen Glass is going to be the one you're going to hear a lot of, because it's not just his coaching credentials, it's the Atlanta United link. The head coach, I think, he's obviously been in interim charge. I think he's obviously coaching in the MLS now. They're partnered with Aberdeen. He's a former Aberdeen player. He's been touted as a future Aberdeen manager, but it's just a case of whether he's ready or not for that.
Yeah, well, that's a thing. I think, and if you're talking about the effect that Gerrard had going into to Rangers, it could have the same effect going in Aberdeen with Stephen Glass. You know, a sort of a factor that, you know, he's not in the British mainland. He's no coaching here. He's out in the MLS. A freshness to come in and galvanise with new ideas. And he's a former player. He knows the demands of the football club. He's been there. You know, he's won the trophy. You know, if you're talking about, he was part of the 95 team that won the trophy. So he knows what it means, and he knows what the standards are at Aberdeen. So I think that's a very, very attractive proposition. And obviously the links with Atlanta and the club. So you might not need to pay a lot of compensation to try and get him out of a job. But I say, again, there'll be a lot of suitors out there that'll be throwing their hat in the ring for the Aberdeen job. And, you know, it's an attractive one, like we spoke about. They've got the training ground. I think there was plans for the new stadium, albeit, you know, you don't know what might happen with that. You know, and see what happens. But yeah, it's interesting times. As you said, Celtic's looking for a manager, Aberdeen looking for a manager, and, you know, strange times. It'll keep the people in the media sort of guessing and speculating. So yeah, so it'll be interesting.